actually explain an important part of the chemistry of the subject.
And what is one to one of these things?
So, N2S plus. N2S plus is a similar cell for in NNC 1727, as it is the source which has the higher abundance of that. And what's going to be due to an intense X-ray field?
Well, this abundance is 40 times higher.
And in this case, you don't have any X-ray field. Actually, the only way you have to explain this is because you have a large amount of nitrogen in the
chemical element.
This is also true
if you look at
NO is perfect line to understand the richness of nitrogen in the envelope. We took our model we have shown previously on temperature and density and so on.
Also a chemical model, this one,
and we brought together to reduce the NO lines and with initial abundances of AUS plus. Yes, I work around. We need to increase the nitrogen abundance by a factor of 20.
And this is putting in this increase in
NO density
and well. The density of abundance is partial need
for the solid to work
to be able to feed
this profile. So this nitrogen chemistry is extremely important in yellow hypergiant stars.
Move fast or
another type of stars.
This type of stars were known some time ago.
They were supposed to be AGB stars, carbon rich, normal stars, but with something peculiar. This first one is the profiles were too wide. No wings, just normal profiles.
Wide profiles
usually mean high mass velocities. High mass velocities usually means high luminosities.
Okay.
Also, the other thing that was for these objects was that
the emission from ICM was really intense.
Again, how a carbonized star would be much different than the rest of the carbonized star. Okay. Then the people claim, authors claim, on a nitrogen enrichment. If we take these two things together, nitrogen enrichment and high mass velocities or high luminosities, we can start to think about massive carbon in the stars. In principle, this cannot be happening, because Hubble don't money will prevent these sources to exist. But actually, there's a way.
Mario
said that under certain circumstances, the Hubble don't money might stop. And in this case, the abundance of carbon will rise again in the photosphere. So we'll have sources showing carbon-rich and nitrogen-rich abundances.
For these sources, we have selected two sources. We are taking tons of data,
CO221 maps.
Yes, I just released a couple of days ago. You see here a peak and two small peaks here, which tend to be, for me at least, variations in the mass losses more easily seen.
It's an asymptotal
average mass, different peaks. So
these probably are, I haven't modeled yet, I just reduced them, probably are mass variations, mass loss episodes similar to what I've shown for yellow hypergiant and what I've seen for
red hypergiant stars.
So with just this, everything seems to go in the good direction. Maybe they are
carbonized stars.
Also, we've obtained
SIO. Those are lines from pathological maps.
We haven't reduced it yet. See, HCM, so we can understand why is this line intense.
Also, it's elusive with path shocks or whatever.
And we also observe land with high. Important thing in these observations
is that we see ammonia.
Again, nitrogen is
high.
So everything grows in the modulation. Hopefully, all results more accurate to grow.
We'll confirm that these ammonia are
massive stars. So, let's finish. We've seen that on the structure part, we have two periods of mass injection, which start with isotropic mass injection, and then we have outflows. First, at the transpiline phase, and then at the geopiline phase. It's true that we may see only for one source, but on geopiline, we obviously have two sources, so we don't have many statistics in that.
And in part of the chemistry, we've seen that nitrogen-rich chemistry is very important for geopiline. For BYCMA, we have rich chemistry or with lines, nitrogen rich species as well, also some tracing gas, great information shown. And we have some objects that show carbon rich and nitrogen rich chemistry, which I revolve massive stars. So we have to change slightly our chemistry view. We used to have these rich stars, low mass stars, and intermediate stars, and then C see a stars. But on Ritz, we have to add something more. This is this.
That's right.
Now we have, well, not just a presentation of Ritz, you have presents, lots of presents that show metronic chemistry as well, Ritz chemistry, and these HVCs, which show carbon Ritz chemistry and nitrogen. And with this slide, I finish. Thank you very much for the attention.
Okay, thanks for a very interesting talk. There is time for questions, so please fire away.
I think the tequila is going
to be more reasonable.
Yeah, if no one else wants to ask something. So you mentioned N2H+ in IRC 10420.
Yes.
And I think the comparison with NGC7927 is a nice one, or it's an interesting one at least. I don't know if I would go so far as to say we know that the N2H plus in NGC-727 is generated by X-rays, although that's the best, I like that explanation, but that's one of two possibilities, right? The other one being there's just an intense UV field that can generate enough ionization traction to do the job.
Oh.
I guess my question is, in this, well, for one thing, we don't know anything about the X-ray properties of IRC-10420, I think.
No, actually it was observed, I think, early this year, and they didn't see it.
With what?
XML, yeah.
Okay. Thank
you. So, I mean, the nature for that would mean that you have plenty of nitrogen, and you just need, instead of having tons of H3 plus to react with nitrogen to generate N2H plus, you have tons of nitrogen and little N2H plus, which will result in this amount of.
Really, I think we proposed to look at IRC-10420 with XMM, so we were really successful with the proposal, it seems. We got the time before we even proposed.
Oh.
We did. Someone else got the time. I don't know who it was, but I think we were looking forward to finding out that results.
Any other questions? What about your isotopic ratios?
Okay. Let's see. CO ratio is more or less what you expect. This is 10 more or less, in a sense. The other one is for CO, or it's more or less what you expect. It's all simple. So that's. But I it's great. Okay, it is. Other thing?
I think this is open. I think Guillermo didn't show it, but when you compare the envelopes, the circumstellar envelopes of GM43 with that of 10420, they are very, very similar, which is, I think, a good indication that they are similar objects. It's important because the parallax of 2343 is not known, so it has been discussed during a lot of time if it is really a yellow hypergiant or a post-AGB source. And it seems really, in our opinion, that it's really very heavy, very heavy star, just because the envelopes are so similar and so different from the typical proprietary memory that really they should be something similar. Do you agree?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I'm convinced that every year 2023 is a yellow hypergiant. You don't see any kind of. I mean, it's perfectly rounded, so it's hard to believe that it's a post-AGB. Also the chemistry and everything looks really similar to IRC-10420, and they are really, really similar, so everything points to one observation.
Any final question? No, and thank you for a very interesting talk.
Thank you very much.